Okay. Good evening. This is Ron. It's a little after 6 p.m. Monday. So we'll go ahead and get started. On yesterday, we spoke about again looking at from a video that Pastor sent, and we talked about that the need for the speaker was saying the need to keep Africa impoverished for the betterment of mankind. And we spoke about that, something that we felt needed to be addressed and put out there. So from that kind of spun other conversations, and a question came out of it about the mindset. So that's where we were the last couple of days, kind of looking at that, taking a closer look at that. Not only the mindset, Nick kind of laid out the mindset of the European, talked about that a little bit. Then we talked about the mindset of the African, and kind of looked at that perspective as well. So that's where we were last couple of sessions. Any questions on anything at all from what I've just discussed, or anything else that may have grabbed your attention? Sorry about the sirens. But anything, anyone?
Hi, Ron. This, well, hi, everyone. Hey, everyone. Can you get it out
Hey.
right? Oh, this is Angela. I had a question.
Hey, Angela, how are you?
Doing good, thank you. I have to find the scripture, but I think it's Revelation. But we've ever talked been talking about what is it, Roman Ra, the Ra, the sun god.
Okay.
And in Revelations, let me see if I can find it. When it talks about, I'm asking this with is related. When it talks about the woman that is clothed with the sun, and I think it's the moon under her feet. I think it's Revel. I say I keep. Let me find it. Get my Bible. I know it's in Revelations 12. I think it's
Well,
the 22nd verse.
we can take a look at it. I'm not sure I'll have an answer. We can discuss it if some of the teachers are in, and we can kind of look at it. You said Revelations 12, Angela? Okay.
Yeah, it's 12.
Okay.
It's beginning at verse 12.
Chapter 12, beginning at verse 12. And for this reason, rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, knowing that he has only a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was thrown down to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child.
Which one you read?
Didn't you say start at verse Revelations 12 and 12?
No, I was talking about chapter 12. I mean, chapter 12, verse 1, I'm sorry.
Chapter 12, verse 1.
Yeah.
And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars, and she was with child, and she cried out, being in labor and pain to give birth. I don't, I'll be honest with you, Angela, I don't understand a lot of the symbolism in Revelation. So I think what this will make a great discussion. If somebody else has some insight into this or see something here, maybe to get us started. But you're asking, is it related to what we were studying about Cush? I don't know. I don't see that yet, just yet. But if no one else has any insight, would you mind if we just kind of table this till everybody can come together? Would that be okay? Does anybody
Yeah,
see
that's fine.
anything here? Does anybody see an answer or? Okay. If you don't mind, you're not here on weekends, are you?
No, not on the weekends. I'm not. Not on
Okay.
Saturday and Sundays. I
Yeah.
work.
I'm going to write this down. Your question is then, is this related to Ra? Is it related to the Cushite?
Yeah.
Okay. That's Revelations 12, 22. I think it's a good question, and I apologize. I don't know the answer. But I promise I'll bring it up again, okay? When everybody's together, we'll see if we can take a closer look at this. Well, thank you for the question.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anyone else? Anything that you may have seen or heard someone speak of? Okay. There is so much there. I had at one time looked at Second Kings chapter 2, and I mentioned to you guys last week to take a look at that because I want to discuss it. Because it talks about what we were discussing, Merkabah, Merkabah, the whirlwind. We were discussing that, and we were looking at it from the Cushite perspective, and from what we've seen in the scriptures. We're trying to pull all that together, and I'm still looking at it because I'm not seeing it clearly. I'm not quite understanding it. I especially want to see it from the perspective of Pastor's Dream. I really do think we have been placed in another dimension, in another place. And I know some of y'all that kind of talk may sound strange to you. But I think we are moving very quickly now, and as to what we see and what we are able to see in ourselves as far as being able to do things and make differences in the world, be enlightenment into the world. So that's why I want to clear this up and get a better understanding of it. And I got to reading Second Kings chapter 2 and relationship between Elisha and Elijah. Kind of fascinated me, and so I'm looking at that, and I'm still not able to see it clearly, and that's why I haven't gone back to that just yet. But that is something that is kind of has me a little fascinated. So at some point we'll get to that. Okay. Any questions, y'all? There is one verse that really kind of got my attention. Look at Genesis chapter 1. I ran across you hear me talking about different rabbis sometime and different teachers, and there's one that I really like. His name is Benner, and he said something here that I had never seen before, and but I find it fascinating, and I see what he's talking about. Chapter tw excuse me, chapter one of Genesis, and this is just brief because this is an observation. It's not really a lesson, I guess, unless we can get some conversation going with it. I'm going to start at verse 26. Chapter one of Genesis, verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." Now here's the verse. "And God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them." He says something here. I wrote down the plural that says, "And Elohim created." And find my notes. I got notes all everywhere, looks like. The plural, that's Elohim, which is plural, which is a plural of Eloha, Eloah, which is singular. And when you make it plural and it says Elohim, we have always talked about that meaning one yet many, one yet many. And I think that also applies. But he says that this means balance. And I thought about that because we talked a lot about balance. He said this is saying, "And balance created man in his own image." In other words, masculine and the feminine part of God. He said Elohim means being masculine and feminine. So it takes away from it being it becomes genderless because it doesn't matter. In other words, if you get in your car and you drive to the store and you drive home, which eye saw did you use the most? Did you use one eye over the other? Did you use one hand over the other? It doesn't matter because they work as one. And what he's saying here is when you get to the place where you become one, that there is no gender. There is no gender. And I saw this and it just kind of fascinated me. And that's why I think I was trying to think of in the scriptures where it kind of talks about that in the afterlife, there is no marriage. There is no, will we be known as masculine and feminine, or we just be one? Will we all just be one? But that just kind of fascinated me when I saw that, because I've never heard that explained that way. Also, the one yet many still applies. I still see that applies, but what he's saying here is if you can picture this in marriage, he's saying it is impossible to be the image of Elohim unless you can see your masculine and feminine side. So it will take two people coming together to see themselves as Elohim, coming together in this type of enlightenment. But I don't quite agree with that. I think when you and that certainly does apply. Let me put it that way. But I think it also applies that you don't have to be married when you bring that mindset into you, when you operate in that mindset, when you come to the place where you see with your third eye, when you come to the place where your mind does not rule over your soul, when you come to the place where as we've talked about, you no longer walk and move with your free will. You do this, your whole existence is to bring about enlightenment. Your whole existence is to be community. So I don't think that it takes a physical union of a man and a woman to reach this point. But I do see his point. I do see what he's talking about. From his perspective, I understand. But does that make sense to you? That to me is huge. I don't know about you guys, but that to me is I thought kind of an eye opener. Because when you look at it from that perspective, it makes the whole verse make sense. That it's something we've overlooked because of how we view religion. We've overlooked for thousands of years now, and God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Pastor's going to lay this out. Well, first of all, do we have any questions? Questions or comments?
This is Vermel.
Hey,
My
Vermel.
question is, my Bible reads using the word God, but that's supposed to be Elohim.
Elohim, yes.
Okay, so when he's saying let us, he's saying Elohim, which is many.
Yes.
One but many. Okay, all
Well,
right, got it.
yeah, and I'm saying not just one but many. One but many applies to us, to all of us who are on this journey. But he is also saying one of the important aspects of the us is the oneness between the masculine and the feminine energy. You cannot be Elohim, or the one but many could not be the one but many if we do not recognize the feminine energy as well as the masculinity. Does that make sense for Mel?
It does, but then it makes me wonder, as humans on this in this world, it doesn't take all of us to make a decision and make the change. That correct?
Right. The one but many doesn't apply to everybody. Everybody has an opportunity, but
But
everybody
everybody
is,
has a choice to just
yes.
do what they want to do.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Got it.
So if all of us have the choice to become Elohim, if all of us have the choice to see these scriptures, but or to at least submit yourself to understanding truth, but most people do not. And that goes back to what we were talking about yesterday when the man made the statement about Africa. He could care less about being Elohim. His version of God, I suppose, is something he's made up in some religion. You see what I mean? So this is talking about a deep commitment, someone who has a sincere desire to give up their own ambitions to pursue truth.
That
Does it
make
make
that's
sense?
making sense. Yeah,
Yeah.
Israel's, yes.
So what I'm saying is that what we've said before, the one but many, that still applies, but we have also I just never heard it put this way as we look at the feminine side of things and understand what that means. In other words, what he's saying is you grow to a point where it doesn't matter if you're masculine or feminine. It doesn't matter. You are truth. You do what you do and you become what you need to be. Okay.
So, for example, I want to make sure I understand this. In my
Okay.
mind, I'm thinking, given a daily event or any event, If I'm seeking truth, whether I'm the feminine energy that's needed at the moment or the masculine that's needed at the moment, they'll work in unison together.
Say the last part again, whether you're the masculine.
Yeah, in the in an event, if I'm balancing, if I'm trying to figure out how I said it, I can be the feminine energy in that moment of seeking truth, or I can be the masculine energy, the giver, the receiver of the energy, because it's going to be in balance.
I think if we I don't I'm trying to think of a way not to make it complicated. For example, when you especially when the kids were young, when your kids are young, you say something to them, you might have one that needs discipline. You may have one that needs to be treated with love and kindness, and they did similar things. What tells you that? What tells you the tone that you need to use? What tells you whether you need to be firm? What tells me whether or not, what tells you whether or not you need to apply passion or judgment? When you know, whether or not you were say for example, you are in a submissive role, meaning that you may be talking to one of your parents or something. What takes you there? How do you know what to address when a situation comes up, if a problem comes up? You see what I mean? It's not something you give thought to. I intentionally chose relationships where there's love. There is experience. You have you have a history together. So you know how to treat each other. You know what is needed. So we grow to the point in this life, and that is the importance of what we talked about yesterday, moving away from the five senses, the physical part of yourself, into the spiritual part of yourself. You get to where you can feel that vibration and know how to treat everybody. So you make a statement of love and kindness because that's what is needed at that point. Or you make a statement that may be a little more firm because that's what is needed at that point. But it's you do so when you do so without having to think about it, but you're relying on your surrendering of self and feeling the vibration from your soul. You are masculine and feminine, and to the point where there is no duality, it doesn't even matter. You're operating in that. That is who you are. Can somebody help me with that? Can somebody say that a little differently, or? No? Okay. For Bill, does that make sense? Are you muted?
Oh, I'm sorry. It does make sense. It does.
Any thoughts or questions on this, y'all? I think it this kind of fascinated me because this is what we've been talking about all along, and this nugget was there, and I don't know about you, but I missed it. I had never seen this before, I was like, wow, this is what we've always been talking about. This is what we've seen. And I mentioned Pastor, he's going to kind of talk to us again, about Jesus, about the scriptures. The scriptures are still very much relevant, but what we are in the process of doing or trying to carefully do is sort through all the storytelling and all the manipulation stuff and pull out the spiritual things. So, like I mentioned 2 Kings, when Elijah and Elias are traveling on this journey, there is a purpose there. There's something there that I'm not seeing, and I want to see what that is. I'm not so much caring about the story itself, but I want to get the morals out of it. And how does that connect to us? Where is that where we are? It has to apply because that word, the chariot keeps coming up. And I want a full understanding of that. Okay. Anybody? Any questions? Comments?
Hey, Ryan, this is
Yes, sir.
Charles.
Hey, Charles.
I don't have a comment on what you just teach a while ago. I have a comment on when Jesus had told the disciples or the one was around him that I went to my own and my own received me not. And during that time when he would get ready to prosecute him or accuse him of what he was doing, and the people had said, "Release Barabbas and kill Jesus." The religious people was no one was putting that out there. Then everybody else, went on with it too. And now getting back to the first answer I just said, question I just said. Now when it said he went to his own and the own didn't receive him, and we talking about Africa, and we as his people. So you mean to tell me that we didn't receive him in the way that he had came to us? That's what the word is saying, or it's saying something different
Was down.
when it came to his own people, came to his own. Yeah, what is the came to his own mean?
Was his own.
Or who is his own?
Charles, we look at that and we read that as a piece of history, and that's where we've over the years study the Bible like it's history, stuff that has happened in the past. We also look at it as a story. These are stories that we've memorized that without kind of pulling out the spiritual aspects of what is speaking to us. That goes on right now. How many people on this phone right now? I see 3, 6, 9, 12. Each and every one of us have other people, family members in our lives. I've gone, and God bless them. I love them today. I know for a fact that my family loves God. As I'm sure most of you have a very religious family, and they know love God. They love their churches, but they don't embrace what I embrace. They've been invited to come on this line, every one of them. So what I'm saying is, truth is not for everybody. We are the everybody for everybody, if that makes sense. We are the everybody. When the scripture talks about the God, what is it? The being the priest and being the firstborn and getting the getting that kind of blessing, getting that you get that because you are responsible. You get those things because you are responsible for taking care of everybody else, looking out the welfare for everybody else. We are the priests, not only for the nation, but for the globe. So we are experiencing what he was talking about right now, but it's not, it's not a to me anyway, not a very terrible thing. It was done this way. Religion was beat into man. religion was beat into everybody that was not a Caucasian. And you either follow this or you die. And that is still in our DNA. It's still very much a part of us. Even as far as we have come in the last few years, there are still things I struggle with. I had a lady, there's a place that I go, a gym that I go to, and even somebody at work, people that, you know, that I've become friends with, walk up to me and ask me about scripture. And I walked in the other day and I'm thinking, I hope she doesn't come up today. I'm thinking what the stuff we've talked about with Jesus, and I know that's where she's going to come from. I'm like, okay, I want a better understanding of this, because that to me is still an uncomfortable thing. It's still an uncomfortable thing. It resonates with me, but it's still not something that, it kind of left me like, okay, where do you go now? What do you do with this kind of a feeling? So we are very much right there, Charles. I hear what you're saying. We're very much right there. And that is part of the pulling the truth out of these scriptures, out of these stories that they put out here. Pulling the truth is when you do that, you see you. You see yourself. It's not that this is written, that this happened 2,000 years ago or in BC or before Christ or whatever. This is happening now. This is happening right now. So, yeah, I mean, I see what he's saying. I agree. And I agree that you are part of that enlightenment for those who are seeking to gain understanding. Does that make sense at all?
Yes, it makes sense. When I read that and saw it, it put me in that same story.
Yeah.
Now the other question I had asked about when they was getting ready to release Barabbas, whatever his name is, and kill. Say what?
Okay, yeah, I'm listening.
Yep, and the religious people were saying, release the robber that killed Jesus. And then everyone else was there, everybody started chanting it. So, and that's still in Africa. I'm wondering if that was, you know, religion started it. But didn't it's something like we help Hilton too?
It's not the other thing part of that helps, I think, anyway, in our understanding is if and when we stop seeing Jesus as a man. I think that picture was painted so that it could hypnotize people and take them on the journey that they was intended for religion to take them on. But the word is destroyed every day. The word is kept quiet. The word is buried every day. The word is crucified every Sunday, Charles. Every Sunday. So it is a manipulation. Truth is buried. So that's the moral of that. That's the kind of thing I'm talking about, being able to see this and bring it to life now and not seeing this like we did this 100 years ago and we are responsible for it. We're responsible for it right now.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah. So that's what we're trying to do on behalf of mankind. We're trying to understand who we are, understand what we're doing and what this journey is all about. And the beauty of it is some of the things that we have discussed, I think are beautiful and right on point. That is seeing ourselves as a community, seeing ourselves as one, the one yet many, and recognize that we willingly carry this torch on this journey. We carry the light. We carry the light, and we understand the importance of looking at ourselves on the inside and understanding our femininity and seeing that and embracing it in others and embracing everybody. Even when you guys get on this phone and you never utter a word, your energy is felt. You keep coming here and you have a role to play just like anybody else who may ask a question or give a comment. It's the energy. It's the desire for truth. Okay. So all that you were asking, Charles, is still relevant today. It still goes on today. It's not a past thing. It's not just something that happened way back when. The spiritual part of it is it happens now.
Yeah, I understand it. I mean,
yeah.
It when you read stuff like that, and it was in Africa, and that made me start thinking, that was me too. And now, when you just said back then, it's now, because when you don't do what your creator had put before you to do or say, you're still killing him.
let's understand something though. When we talk about Africa, whether it's talking about with Jesus, whether we're talking about scriptures, the man said something in the video. He said talked about the resources, and he's talking about material things. He's talking about natural resources and wealth and stuff that people need, but in the spiritual sense, the resources that is needed in the earth are the Africans that are on this phone right now. And what we're trying to do, we are trying to pull those resources out. We're trying to see who we are. We're trying to see what truth really looks like. We're trying to understand how to activate that third eye. We're trying to understand how to piece this together and see what truth is and what direction we're supposed to go on. We're trying to learn how to pray. We're trying to learn how to communicate with the Creator and communicate and rely on each other. We are the resources. The resources are spiritual. That's the Africa that is needed. That's the Akebalon that is needed. Not the Africa, the Akebalon that is needed. That is the dark energy that brings enlightenment to the earth. Make sense? Charles, anybody?
Yes, sir. It makes sense to me.
There's one more thing I wanted to go over if nobody had any questions about this to me. Let me find this. You guys are quiet. You must have had a long day.
I'm taking it in.
Okay. Meet me at Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Please. Oh, Ron, come on. I'm finding it, y'all. Hold on. Okay, I'm at Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I'm still talking about that first verse. I'm still talking about this verse in excuse me, that first chapter of Genesis, and God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. I'm still talking about that. But listen to Ecclesiastes here and see what you think of this. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. For everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What does that have to do with this verse? And God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him male and female. He created them. What does that have to do with this? When you recognize, when we recognize who we are, when we concentrate on being the spiritual me, when I ask, Lord, show me who I am, I surrender this vessel. I surrender my ambition. I surrender whatever it is that has kept me from you. I want to know who I am. I want to know what truth looks like. I want to understand the scriptures. I want to know what it means to go back to beginning. I want to be able to bring peace to my mind. I want to be able to bring peace to the earth. Make me a vessel. Show me what I must do. Show me who I am. So everything is captured up in my being a male and a female. When I reach that point, there is no decision that I make. For everything, there is a season, a time, and a purpose. Every piece of light and darkness is in that version of recognizing that I'm male and female. Every piece of good and evil is in that verse that speaks to me being male and female. Every decision I made when I was talking to Vermil about giving her example or talking to her children, every decision that is made is wrapped up in that verse. Those things that seem like duality, those things that this is good, this is bad, this is light, this is dark, this is good, this is evil, this is heaven, this is earth, all of it is wrapped up in recognizing that I am Elohim. All of it is wrapped up in recognizing that I am male and I am female. That is my energy. That is my balance. Elohim means balance, balance, balance. And when we understand that and see it from this perspective, what this is saying in Ecclesiastes 3 is you, when you're operating in rhythm, nothing surprises you. You know what to do in every situation. It doesn't matter a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up. You operate in the vibrations that you are. And you don't stop to think, did my right hand pick up this cup or did my left hand? Am I male now? Am I female in the words that I'm speaking? You become who the Creator has designed you to be. And when we see that inside of ourselves and we start recognizing and appreciating and respecting it in everybody else that we see and we meet, that's what changes the world. But right now, as Charles brought up in his questions, we are the enlightenment. We are the peacemakers. And part of the verse that talks about putting your light on the bushel basket, we don't do that. You are the light. It is time we are at the action part of this thing. We are walking in who we are. Does this make sense, y'all?
Yes, it does.
A time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. In other words, be balanced. Be balanced. Well, if you don't have any thoughts or questions, that's all I had for this evening. I hope this made sense to you. I hope it resonates. And if you have any thoughts or questions, we can address it again at some point, maybe. I also have Angela's questions. It's probably we'll no problem. We'll look at that Saturday when everybody's on the line. Okay. All right.
Okay.
Appreciate you. Yes, ma'am.
No, I'm saying okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
It. Yeah. Y'all have a good week. Be careful. Be safe. Enjoy. I think it's sunny. Pretty days and enjoy. Okay. Enjoy yourself.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.